This is a code walkthrough for the example file cs12dateusage.java. So let's open up this file and take a look. I'll scroll up to the top here. The purpose of this file is to demonstrate the usage of many of the API methods of the cs12date class. So for starters, to run this file, we have to make sure that both this file and the cs12date class that it depends upon are both mutually visible to each other. So for our purposes, if we have them in the same directory, we're good to go. Now, just as a test, as always, let's compile this file. And it compiles cleanly. And notice that not only did we compile this file into its equivalent .class bytecode file, but we also compiled the cs12date class that it depends upon into a bytecode file. If a Java class relies on some other classes, it will compile those classes as well. So again, this example file exercises the cs12date class. What can the cs12date class do? Well, that's an answer best answered by the API. You might want to refer back to this PDF file, which should be in this week's lecture materials, which contains the cs12date API. Remember that an API contains the constructors, or how we can create an object of a certain type, and then everything that we can do with that class. So you might want to have this on hand to refer to. This example is going to exercise most of the methods in the API. So let's take a quick look at this file. The way it's set up is we're creating a number of cs12date objects using various constructor forms, and then we're simply printing them out and doing things to them. For example, in this block of statements, we're simply printing out each of these created objects using the toString method explicitly. So we're getting the string representation of each of these dates. Here, we're doing the same thing, but we're printing out each object implicitly. So for example, this print statement using the object name Independence Day is an easier way of accomplishing this statement right here using object.method, IndependenceDay.toString. I think you're going to find that this is a much easier way of printing out your objects. Here, we're exercising the print method upon each of these objects. And remember that the print method is something provided in this class that shows the internal details of each of these objects. Useful for understanding how a class operates, but it's definitely not a standard type of thing. And then in the rest of the code which follows, we're simply following the paradigm of do something to an object using one of its methods and print out the state of the object. Do something else to an object, print out its new state. Do something, print it out. And notice that we've got these print statements here. This is a print statement taking no input arguments. So what this is doing is it's just printing a blank line for output readability. Notice also that we've got related statements grouped with a little bit of white space in between them, and we're commenting each related block of statements. This is how I'd like you to work toward in organizing your own code and your programs. And finally here, we're using some of the accessor methods, the getters, to pull out certain fields, the month, day, and the year, and we're just printing those out with some labels. Whenever you're printing something out, make sure you've got some kind of accompanying label to go along with the data. And that's pretty much everything that we're doing in here. So let's scroll back up to the top of the file. We've already compiled it. Let's try to run it. Yay, a whole bunch of stuff went scrolling by. So the file works. There's nothing corrupted about it. But let's step through it a little bit slower and understand what it's doing. So we'll use the debugger. We'll set a breakpoint on main. And this time I'll click the debug icon, and I'm going to single step my way through this. So notice that when we create each of these cs12date objects, we have them created here in the left pane in the debugger, and we can click on this key-like icon and expand each of these objects. And now we can see the underlying detail, the month, day, and the year fields for each of the objects. Remember that each of these are CS12 date objects. They all have month, day, and year fields, but each of these is a specific instance of that class, so they all have their own values. And moving on, we're simply going to print what each of these objects is using its string representation, month/day/year representation, and a blank line. And now we're going to do the same thing, except we're going to use toString implicitly. So all we're doing is we're just using the name of the object as a regular old variable. And I think you'll find it's the same output, but it's much easier. And now we're going to print a few things out using the print method. And what that does is it prints the provided header here, along with all of the internal details in a nicely labeled format, a label and a data field. So this is just a nice way of visualizing all the internal information. And moving on, we're going to set one of the dates to an explicit value. And notice what happens when we change it. Any field that's changed shows up in red here in the left window. So we can see when our program changes data. So again, we're changing the month now and printing it out, moving the date 10 days back using the prior date method and printing it out. Let's advance the date by 5 days. Changes as expected. Now let's extract some fields into individual scalars. So we've plucked out the month of Independence Day into its own dedicated int variable and printed it. Pulled out the day, printed it. The year, print it. This one's a little odd. What we're doing here is we're pulling out the date num, which is the numerical date within the year. So for example, January 1st is day number 1. December 31st is day number 365, or 366 for a leap year. So this one ought to be about the middle of the year. 186 seems about right. So we'll advance Independence Day using next date and printing it. And we can also do this kind of thing in our outputs. This is a nice visual separator. So we've got a blank line, a bunch of dashes, and another blank line. And here we're exercising the equals method. We're just checking if this date object and this date object are the same. And the equals method returns a Boolean value. So chances are they won't be the same. So this should probably return a false. And it does. And this one also is false. And we can print these Boolean variables just like any other variables using a statement such as this and printing out a Boolean variable. And finally, we can check the equivalence of two dates. A date had better be equal to itself, so this one had better return a true result. And it does. And we're good. And now we've reached the end of the program. So doing something like this on your own, exercising all the individual methods of an API, is a good way to learn your way around a new Java class. Just refer to the class's API, create some objects, change the objects up, and use whatever display methods it provides to show what the new state of the object is. You'll be doing a lot of this in coming programs, but I just wanted to sort of demonstrate this idea to you with the CS12 date class that we've just gone over.